this morning that the scripture never promised that we weren't going to have rain and storms. He never said that walking after Jesus, following after him, was going to relieve us of the pressures of this world. But our hope isn't in the weather, our hope is in the rock. Our hope is on the rock of Jesus. And so when the storms come, we cling to the rock because he's the one that stays faithful. And that wind, guess what? If you live in Chicago, you know the storms come in 5 minutes, they're gone. Rains will come and go, but our hope is in Jesus, our firm foundation, our refuge. Psalm 18, just like what we said earlier, we love the Lord because he is our deliverer. He is our rock. He is our refuge. And so we can say the words, you're my firm foundation. You won't fail. And we can sing it over each other that he won't, because we remember throughout our lives the times when the storms came and it was like we were barely hanging on, but we remember that he was gripping us. And so this morning as you come in, God, you see so many people that are coming in that there's a storm around them or there's just something that they're carrying in here. Lord, would you help our eyes turn upwards to you? Would you help us remember your faithfulness? Would you keep our eyes and our hearts steady on you? The enemy is a liar and tells us that we can't hope. But we know that you are our rock, our fortress, our refuge in times of trouble. And so would we remember that the righteous run into that tower of refuge and are safe. So the rains may come and the winds will blow, but God, would we be people that have built our lives on you?
Church, sing this.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high.
Aren't you glad you came to church this morning?
Yeah, me too. Me too.
Hey, it's Father's Day. Hope you heard. And we wanted to just take a moment to encourage our dads and all the fathers in our church, and also to pray for them. And we want to remind you that we have the ultimate Father, our perfect Heavenly Father, as our hope, as our foundation, as our example. So we want to read a portion of God's word from Psalm 127, verse 3 says this: "Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children of one's youth. Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them." If you are a father, you might remember that, hey, you're going to be a dad, and you're like, yes. And then, hey, you're a dad. Whoa, that's a big job. And it is the greatest gift and blessing. And it is a big responsibility. And sometimes you can feel the weight of that. And I don't know if you measure your kids' ages in weeks or months or years or decades, or they have their own kids. But guys, we have such an incredible opportunity to invest in our kids, to lay a foundation of faith in Jesus Christ. That's going to look different, right? Different times, different seasons, but the Lord's faithful in all of it. We want to encourage you with that. So guys, we know this: you need strength, and the Lord is your strength. And you need wisdom, and the wisdom we need will come from the Lord through His word. And it matters so much that we would persevere, that we would be faithful, and God is faithful to you. And so we're thankful for you, and we want to encourage you, and we know this: our help comes from the Lord. Unless the Lord builds a house, we labor in vain. That would be horrible. And so we just, today, want to seek the Lord, ask Him for help, ask Him for strength, that He would help us as dads, not to be apathetic, not to miss our opportunity, but to invest as the Lord would have us invest with our kids. So if you're a father, we're going to pray. If you're a father who needs help, that's you, if you're a father. Just hold your hand out maybe like this, like, Lord, I receive your help today. And everybody else, let's pray for our dads, okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, what a great reality that you are our perfect Heavenly Father. There's none like you. You love perfectly, you see perfectly, you are perfectly faithful. Lord, would you help the dads in our church to anchor their hope and their priorities in you, to trust you, to follow you, to be full of hope, to be full of humility. Lord, help us in the best of seasons to give you the praise and the glory. Help us in the hardest of seasons to get on our knees to pray for our children. Lord, we see the tremendous privilege, and we feel the weight of the responsibility. So Lord, we pray that you would help us to anchor our kids' hope in Jesus and Jesus alone. And we pray, Lord, that these kids would be arrows sent on your mission for your agenda, taking the baton of faith beyond our lives. So Lord, in all of it, we honor you, and I pray that you would help us as fathers to walk humbly with our God. Thank you that you're faithful. Thank you for the blessing you give us. We pray all this together in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. Let's continue in worship.
To look upon the one who bled to see.
Yes, he is worthy, he is holy. That's why we gather and worship him today. Hey, why don't you go ahead and take a seat? We've got a couple things we want to connect on as a church and just make sure we're communicating. First of all, I want to welcome everybody who's here. Of course, happy Father's Day to all the dads. And I want to just say that if you're new or new-ish to Harvest, if we haven't met yet, man, we'd love to say hello. So don't rush out. I'm going to go over to the welcome area out here in the lobby, and it'd be our privilege to say hello and get to meet you today before you go. We're glad you're here. For everybody, every time, we encourage you to use the Connect card. Yeah, I did that last week, Dave. Yeah, I know. We want to do it again. And here's why. It's because we care about you. It's because we want to know that you're here. And we want to know, is there a way we can pray for you? So our staff every week prays through every prayer request, and that's an opportunity. So you can do that through the app, Harvest Bible Chapel Chicago. Get the app, and that actually has a lot of great resources on it. Or use the QR code. It's on the seats right in front of you. The point is this. We're a church family. We want to connect. We want to know if we can help you. So let's use the Connect card each time we come. Big announcement, guys. This is perfect for Father's Day. Summer camp is coming up for our junior high and our high school students. Dads, I would just encourage you right now, return all the gifts and put all the resources into getting your kids to camp, all right? This is a big deal. This is one of the best opportunities we have to intensely and purposely invest in our kids' spiritual lives. And so for junior high students and for high school students, it's coming where our students are going to go up to Camp Harvest. Junior high is the 12th of July, 12th through 16. High school is a couple weeks later, July 26th through July 30th. Guys, I've had the chance, moms and dads, I've had the chance to watch this year after year, and my kids come back with a more fervent walk with Jesus Christ. Yes, they have a blast. Yes, it's beautiful. Yes, good relationships, all of that, but this is a great opportunity. Please work to overcome the obstacles for your kids to do this. And if money is one of them, please come and talk to us, because we'd love to do our best to make sure that we can overcome those things, because we love your kids and we want to invest in them. With that, we've got our junior high ministry this morning, right, Larry? So this is Pastor Larry. We're going to encourage all of our junior high students right now to get up. It won't be embarrassing, I promise. To get up, to go over with Pastor Larry. You guys are going to spend a little time during the service together in God's Word. Let's encourage our junior high students. Isn't that great? That's awesome. And we're also going to give an opportunity right now to give. And I want to remind you of what Scripture says in 1 Corinthians 10:31. It says, "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God." That's really quite a sentence, isn't it? All. Everything. My work, my leisure, my relationships, my singing, my serving, my giving. All of it to give glory to God. And so we're not going to pass an offering today, but there are digital ways to give. You can see them on the screen, whether it's a text or an email or website or any of those things. It's a heart thing, guys. There's also boxes in the room if you came prepared, but we put this opportunity out because our God is worthy, and because we respond from the heart, and because we want to give him glory in everything we do. So we're going to pray about that in just a minute. We're also going to pray for a local church, another local church, Calvary Memorial Church, Oak Park. This is pastored by Gerald Heestand. Now, Gerald is actually a friend of mine, of many of you, and it was a pastor on our staff. I texted him this week. I said, "Gerald, how can we pray for your church?" He said, "Pray, because we're going after outreach and evangelism." I'm like, all right. So let's pray for them as we pray for all the things going on in our church too. Let's pray together. Lord, we love that we belong to you, and we recognize it is because of you. You set your love upon us. And so in this moment, Lord, would you help us to look through our life and to prioritize giving you glory in all that we do. Yes, in our worship. Yes, in our receiving of the word. Yes, in our giving. It belongs to you, Lord, so receive it today. Thank you for the work you're doing in our church. Help us to be faithful. Help us to grow up in you. Help us to reach out with the name of Jesus Christ everywhere we can. Lord, we want to pray for Calvary Memorial. Thank you for a faithful church. Thank you for your faithfulness to them. And thank you, Lord, for Pastor Gerald and all who serve there. Lord, would you help them as they want to be a light for Jesus Christ in their community? Draw people to you, Lord, not to a church, but to you.
We love you, Lord. We commit this all to you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to continue in worship through our time in the Word. We're starting a new series today. You're going to want to grab your Bible. If you want to take notes, get ready for that. And we'll be in the Word here in just a moment. Good morning, church.
Good morning. It's good to see you. Yes. Hi. Wow. Good to see you. And we want to welcome our campuses who are joining us, Crystal Lake and Rolling Meadows and Aurora. We're so glad that you're with us, coming together for God's Word, and we love you guys. And I just want to say Happy Father's Day to everyone. If you haven't heard it already today, Happy Father's Day. We love the fathers of our church, and what a blessing and what a great responsibility it is to be a father, especially as we seek to reflect our Heavenly Father to our kids. And so I hope that you feel celebrated today, dads. We love you. Happy Father's Day. Well, this morning, I want to let you know that we are starting a new series this morning called Ask Anything. And if you were here last week, you remember that we asked you to ask us maybe some questions that you have, whether it's about the Bible or doctrine or issues that are coming up in the culture. We wanted you to ask us some questions. And let me tell you, I looked last night. You asked us some questions. We got a lot of questions, and I'm really excited to be walking through some of those as a church together in sermons. I think last time I looked, we had over 150, maybe close to 200 questions. And so our series is only 8 weeks long, so you could do the math there. It doesn't quite line up. So we are currently even just brainstorming ways that we can bring answers to a lot of those questions that you've had, whether that's through video or podcast, or we're still spitballing it. So we're hoping to answer as many as we can, and I'm really excited to dive into this as a church together. And here's where we're starting. This is the first. It's not really a question. It's more of a phrase. It is love the sinner, but hate the sin. This is a very popular phrase. Maybe you've heard this, yes? Raise your hand if you have heard or seen this phrase somewhere in your life, like almost everyone, right? It's not a new phrase, but this is a increasingly popular phrase that's being said in modern Christianity in this day and age. And maybe you've noticed it. I have certainly noticed it in the past couple of years, this phrase being used more and more and more. And one thing that I've noticed about the phrase is how people use it in a wide variety of applications. So some of the people use it in different contexts. And what I mean by that is some people, when they say this phrase, love the sinner, hate the sin, what they mean is they mean that God loves the sinner, but hates the sin. In some cases, they say it as in, I love the sinner, but hate the sin, right? And in some cases, they mean both. I love the sinner, but hate the sin, because God loves the sinner and hates the sin. And so those are a couple of the contexts, but there's also a couple of motivations that people use while using this phrase as well. I think that probably the most popular motivation is to tell people that God loves them, but he is not approving of their actions. That God loves you, but he's not approving of your actions. I think some people, though, use this as a springboard into judgment. They kind of lowercase the God loves you, and they uppercase the God hates your sin, right? God loves you, but he hates your sin. And they're sitting around and they're pointing fingers at all of the sinners, right? Some people use it in that way. Some people use this with the motivation of permissiveness. God loves you. Listen, he loves you. Yeah, he doesn't like the sin thing, but he loves you, your authentic self. He loves you for who you are, so you don't have to really change anything about you because he loves you, right? And then that leads to more of this permissive excuse of sin. So a lot of context, a lot of motivations that this phrase is used in. And I think we have to start at the most basic question. Is it true? Is the phrase, God loves the sinner but hates the sin, is that a true phrase? Is it a true aphorism? And really, whenever we come across any question like this from culture or a question of doctrine or a question of the Bible, our first move should always be to see what God's word has to say about it. That should be our absolute first move, whether it's a question from culture or of doctrine or theology. What does God's word say about it? And it's not only important about our topic for today, but every topic that we're going to be going through as a church together. What does God's word have to say about it? So, let's see what God's word has to say about this phrase. Let's tackle the first part of that phrase first. Let's talk about love, right? And I've decided to outline this phrase with other phrases. So the section that we're going to start first with is for the love of God. For the love of God, we're going to do a little theology of God's love, especially as it relates to the sinner. Does God love the sinner? Well, let's look at some verses. Let's start with probably the most popular one, John 3:16. For God so loved the world, mankind, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. It's pretty promising, right? Seems like God loves the world, mankind, sinners alike. Romans 5:8 says, but God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus brings a little bit of more to this verse in John 15:13. He says, greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. So let's go back to Romans 5:8. Christ died for us while we were still sinners, and this is the greatest love, that one would lay down their life for their friends. And Jesus laid down his life for us while we were still sinners. The Bible is seeming to indicate that God demonstrates, shows love to sinners, right? And then we finally see this in 1 John 4:8. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. God is love. God doesn't just do loving things. God doesn't just act in love. He is love. It is his very nature, not just an action that he does. He loves because he is love, and he is always love and will always be love, meaning he will always act in love every time, all the time. It is his nature. I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm a bit of a hobbyist. I tend to rotate around several different hobbies. Sometimes they change week to week, sometimes day to day. Some are a little longer than others. And maybe you remember last year, I got into the hobby of running, right? The thing about it is that I don't just do hobbies, okay? I become the hobby, okay? I didn't just do the running, I was the running, okay? I was Tommy the runner. And what do runners do? They run marathons. And so I stupidly signed up for one, because that's what runners do. And I am that. I identify as the runner, right? I am my hobby. I also cycle, and I don't just cycle. It's not just something I do. I am a cycler, spandex and all, okay? That's a picture you didn't need this morning, right? I'm that guy, all right? I'm that person who you're frustrated with as you're driving on the road. That's me. Most recently, I have got into the modeling of miniatures and building them and painting them, and I am not just someone who does that. I am that. Okay, you're saying nerd alert, yeah, totally. And I am that, I own that, and it's basically what all my conversations consist of. I'm talking about it. This is who I am, right? I am my hobbies. So God doesn't just love sinners. He is love. It's not just something that he does, it's who he is. And unlike me, where I change hobbies every 2 seconds, God never changes. He is unchanging. He is love, always has been love, and always will be love. There is no change or variation in him. And so we can make the conclusion that because God is love and acts in love all the time, that he is loving and acts in love towards sinners. So then we have to ask the question, how does God love sinners, right? How does he love the sinner? Well, again, because God is love, it is unconditional. It is because it is who he is. It is his nature. It is without condition. It's also what I would call a benevolent and merciful love. A benevolent and merciful love. Matthew 5, 44 through 46. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. So to be sons of the Father who is in heaven, to be imitating the Father who is in heaven, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and on the unjust. This is God's love shown through his loving common grace to all people, the just and the unjust. He is providing them with common goodness and care. The sun is rising on them. He sends the rain to them because he is acting in common loving grace. But it is also a merciful love. And we know this because we know that the consequences of sin is death, right? Romans tells us. The wages of sin is death. Spiritual death. Separation from God for all eternity. But in that, we see God's patient love. In that, when the sinner sins, they don't receive the eternal punishment for the sin the moment that they sin. Because that is God's patient love, his merciful love acting towards them. He has a patient love towards them. God loves sinners in the way that he calls them to repentance and belief in Jesus Christ. Making a way for salvation is an act of love. One, by the way, that we do not come even close to deserving. And yet he has made a way for salvation. He shows his love by calling the sinner to repentance. Romans 2, 4 says, "Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance?" It is God's loving kindness that leads us to repentance. God loves the sinner. So I think we have to also know that God also has a distinct love for his children. God's love is not uniform with sinners and his children. He has a distinct love for his children. And how does he love his children? Well, he saves his children. He has specific blessings for his children. He gives his children an inheritance. He helps his children. He comforts his children. He teaches and guides his children. It's kind of like us as parents, right? Like, as a father, listen, I love children. I love all the children. They're amazing and funny and so innocent, and they say the darndest things, right? And I love all the children. But I love my children with a distinct love. I don't love all of the children in the same way that I love my children. I love my children very distinctly. They receive blessings and gifts that other children in my life do not receive because they're my children. And there is a distinct love set upon my children. You have a distinct love set upon your children. God is like that as well. He has a distinct love for his children. In fact, it's one of the problems with the statement, with the phrase, God loves sinners but hates the sin. It's because what it does is it seeks to make his love uniform as if he loves the sinner in the same exact way as he loves his children. It is not uniform. God loves his children in a distinct way. God's love also differs from the world's love. 1 Corinthians 13 gives us kind of the best definition that we have for godly love, right? If we go through that passage, we can see pretty clearly how different God's love is versus the world's love, the love that we're taught by the world, right? God's love, as we've mentioned, is unconditional. It is unconditional. All people, no matter what they do, sinner, saint, it's unconditional. Versus the world's love, which is very conditional, right? I only love the people I like. I only love the people who I agree with. If you cross me, not only do I not love you, but I actually hate you, right? The world's love is conditional, very conditional. God's love is patient. The world's love is impatient. God's love is long-suffering. And I think all we have to do is look at the divorce rates in our world today to realize that the love of the world is not a patient love. As soon as I'm not getting what I want, I'm out. It is impatient. It is not long-suffering. God's love is selfless. The world's love is selfish. What can I get? What have you done for me today, right? It is selfish, where God's love is, what can I give you in my goodness and mercy? God's love does not rejoice in wrongdoing. The world's love, as we've seen very recently, does in fact rejoice in wrongdoing, sometimes going to the extent of saying that the greatest love is loving wrongdoing. God's love rejoices in the truth. The world's love does not rejoice in the truth. It rejects the truth. It's offended by the truth. So it's a very different love, God's love, than the world, the worldly love that we have grown and learned from the world. So I think when we see things like that, we have to ask ourselves a question. When I look at my life, when you look at your life, whose love am I imitating more closely in my everyday life? The love of God or the world's love? In that list, am I lining up more with how God loves, or am I lining up more with how the world shows love? So God loves sinners. Do we agree with this? Do we see this in God's word? It's an okay statement. God loves sinners. All right, good. Let's move on to the next part of the phrase. Let's talk about hate. That's a phrase you want to hear in church, right? Let's talk about hate right now, guys, all right? The title of this next section is A Love-Hate Relationship. A Love-Hate Relationship. This is the second part of the phrase. So we have God loves sinners. Now we have, but God hates sin. Let's ask the question, does God hate sin? Well, let's see what the Bible has to say about this particular issue. Proverbs 6, 16 through 18. There are six things that the Lord loves? No, hates. Seven that are an abomination to him. And those are haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, and feet that make haste to run to evil. What are the things being described here? Sin, right? These are sinful actions. That's what's being described here. And it says that God hates these things. Psalm 45, 7 says, you have loved righteousness and hated wickedness or sin. God loves righteousness and hates wickedness. Deuteronomy 12, 31, you shall not worship the Lord your God in that way, for every abominable thing that the Lord hates, they have done for their gods. This is idolatry, talking about idolatry and bringing false worship, the way that they would worship their false gods, bringing that into the worship of God. Deuteronomy 16, 22 is very similar to this. You shall not plant any tree as an Asherah beside the altar of the Lord your God that you shall make, and you shall not set up a pillar which the Lord your God hates. Psalm 5, 4 says, for you are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil may not dwell with you. What is the opposite of delight? seems to indicate that God hates sin, right? God's word seems to indicate that God hates sin. And why does God hate sin? Well, it's because God is holy. It's because God is pure. It's because God is righteous. It's because God is just. And sin is in direct opposition to his very nature of being holy and righteous and just and pure. And God hates things that are contrary to his nature. I think he also hates it because of its effect on his creation as well. It separates us from him. It deceives us to follow the world instead of him. It seeks to destroy us and it seeks to enslave us to itself. And it blinds us to the truth of God. It's why he hates sin. It's opposite his nature. My nature, by the way, you probably don't know this about me either, is I am always warm. Always. You're like, not always. Always. In fact, my kids affectionately call me the furnace. Like whenever they're cold, they just snuggle up close to me because I am literally always warm. I'm warm right now. I'm sweating. Always. All the time. Never am I not. Doesn't matter what temperature it is. Could be 100 degrees. I'm warm. Could be 30 degrees. I'm warm. Right? Always happening. It is like my very nature. Maybe something's wrong with me. I don't know. Only the Lord knows. But I know that I'm always warm. And here's the thing about that is I actually hate the cold. I hate being cold. Hate it. I do not like it. I do not like feeling cold whatsoever, ever. I hate being cold. It is opposite to my nature. And so you're probably wondering, like, why on earth do you live in Illinois? Like, it's cold here. Yes, it is, and I hate it, all right? I hate the cold. And if we could plant a church, like, you know, in where it's warm, that would be amazing. But here's the thing. My wife is actually the opposite of me. She is always cold, and she hates the warm. And so we will never go because my Bible tells me that I am to love my wife and lay myself down for her. And so I will remain here and continue to hate the cold because it is opposite of me. He hates what's opposite to his nature in the same way sometimes that we do. And so we see that God, it seems to indicate in the Bible that God loves the sinner but hates sin. Right? We see that. So what's the problem with this phrase? What's the problem with this phrase? God loves the sinner but hates the sin. Well, first, it's an oversimplification. It's an oversimplification. We just saw how much of an oversimplification is by going just through a couple of verses about God's love and his hatred of sin, right? It oversimplifies God's love and his displeasure of sin. It also assumes some things about God's love. Again, we talked about that. That it is uniform for the sinner and the saint. The other problematic thing about this phrase is that it is misleading and it is incomplete. This phrase, do you notice? God loves the sinner, but hates the sin. It seeks to separate the sinner from the sin, right? God loves the sinner, but hates the sin. It is seeking to separate those two things, and that is not a separation that God makes. On the last day, on judgment, when God is going to judge the wicked, is he taking and just judging the sin and throwing the sin into hell? No. Who is being judged? The sinner. God does not make distinction between sinner and sin. He judges the one who is guilty. He judges the sinner and sin. He does not separate him. In fact, the most quoted verse in the Bible, by the Bible, I don't know if you know, but the Bible tends to quote itself pretty often. And this is the most quoted verse in the Bible, by the Bible. And it is where God reveals his love of who he is to Moses. If you remember the story, Moses went up to the mountain and received the Ten Commandments. And while he was away, the people were like, where's Moses? He's been gone for too long. High priest Aaron, make us a god because Moses is gone. And Aaron does. He makes them a golden calf, and they worship this false god. While Moses is up receiving the Ten Commandments, Moses comes down. He sees what's happening. He breaks the commandments, right? He throws them down. Then he has to go back up on the mountain later and receive them again. And while this is taking place, after all of that sin has happened by Israel, Moses goes up to the mountain again, and God reveals himself. He says, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. We see God's love on display. This is who God is. He is slow to anger, patient in his love, steadfast, unmoving in his love, faithful, loyal in his love. And who is he speaking this about? He's speaking this right after the golden calf worshipers, the sinners who have turned away from God to false gods, those who worship golden calves. He's sharing this is what his love is like, that he is abounding in steadfast love and patient, slow to anger. But here's the end of it. But who will by no means clear the guilty? So God's love, God loves. Other translations say, but will by no means allow the guilty to go unpunished. God loves, but he does not allow the guilty to go unpunished. The guilty person will be judged and will not be saved from God's wrath. God does not separate sin from sinner on the day of judgment. This is so important to us, church, because when we say phrases like this to people, it can mislead them into robbing them of the warning of judgment and wrath. It can mislead them into thinking that there's going to be a separation of their sin and the sinner. But the only thing, listen to me, the only thing that can separate sin from sinner is the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. That is it. Not a phrase, not an aphorism. The only thing that can separate sin from sinner is the forgiveness offered by Jesus Christ. And so I think we have to actually ask a pretty uncomfortable question as we're walking through this. Love the sinner, hate the sin. We also have to ask the question of, does God hate sinners? It's a pretty controversial subject. Does God hate sinners? Let's look at what God's word has to say about this as well. Proverbs 6, this is the end of 16 through 18. This is verse 19, right? So six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him, lists off sinful actions. Then it says, a false witness who breathes out lies and the one who sows discord among brothers. Do you see the shift happening in the verse? It's not just now the sinful action. It is the one who does the sinful action. Psalm 5:4, we saw this part. You are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil may not dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all evildoers. Not evil, evildoers. Even more harshly, Psalm 11:5, the Lord tests the righteous, but his soul hates the wicked. And the one who loves violence. Seems to indicate that God hates the wicked. Now, there are three views on this, and I want to share them with you. The first view is that this is something called metonymy. So metonymy is an exaggerated statement metonymy is a figure of speech in which a word is substituted for another word that it is closely associated with, right? So an example of a metonymy is like if we said, the White House spoke today on taxes, right? Did the White House actually speak? No, we understand that to be a substitute for the presidential administration, right? And so some people believe here in the verse that the word sinner is a metonymy for the word sin. That the word sinner is a replacement, a metonymy, a figure of speech for the word sin. And so God still just hates sin, right? That's the metonymy view on this. There's also a view that this is hyperbole. Hyperbole is the exaggerated statement or claim that is not meant to be taken literally, right? Example of hyperbole, I'm so hungry, I could eat a horse, right? I could not eat a horse. It's an exaggerated claim, not meant to be taken literally. And so some people actually believe that the word hate is hyperbole. It is exaggerated. God is just really angry. God is just really mad. Don't you see how mad he is about sin? Or they say, well, God just prefers righteousness over sinfulness. He prefers one more than the other. This is hyperbole. That's the second view. And the third view is the plain reading of the text. This is what the text says at face value, that God indeed does hate sinners. And so I want to be completely transparent with you. I and which viewpoint I tend towards. I tend towards the plain reading of the scripture, and I want to tell you why. I have too many problems with metonymy and with hyperbole. Hyperbole, for example, we actually have a perfect example of this in Psalm 45:7. This is one of the problems, is that through the Psalms, what's happening, the psalmists are contrasting two things, wickedness and righteousness, right? The wicked and the righteous. He's making this contrast, and he's saying, how does God feel about this? How should we feel about this? And he's making these contrasts. And so the hyperbole people would say, well, that hate is not the word, it's hyperbole. It just means he's really angry. And so if this is hyperbole, then what are we to do with that word? If this is exaggerated, is this also exaggerated? Does God not actually love righteousness? Does he not actually love the righteous? So if this is hyperbole, then that must be hyperbole. That's why I have a problem with that. It's the same thing with metonymy. And so I tend towards the plain reading of the text. And I think something that might be helpful in this is to mention that God doesn't hate like we hate. Do you know that? In the same way that God doesn't love in the way that we love, God doesn't hate in the way that we hate. Our hate is filled with sinful implication, sinful desire. God's hate is pure. He is pure and holy. No blemish in him whatsoever. And so really, even in the Psalms, what the psalmist is doing is when he says sinner and when he says righteous, the righteous person or the sinner, these really are titles over people's lives. I believe that they're titles over certain types of people's lives. The righteous person is a person who has trusted in God, who is following God. That is the righteous person, because we know that the Bible tells us that no one is righteous, no, not one. And so what could possibly be making this person the righteous person? Well, it's only God, right? And so this is the title over their life, as one who follows God and walks with God, the righteous. Whereas the sinner, this is also a title over someone's life, and this is the person who has rejected God completely and continues to do so until the end. This is the sinner. So you have the righteous and the sinner, and God loves righteousness and hates the sinner, the sin, and this hate is an intense disapproval of a quality of a person, namely their rebellion and their sinful heart. It is an intense disapproval of their rebellion and sinful heart. I think that Hosea 9:15 does a really great job of showing us the beauty through some pretty wonderful poetry of God's love and hate. Every evil of theirs is in Gilgal. There I began to hate them because of their wickedness, because of the wickedness of their deeds. I will drive them out of my house. Hosea actually shows the relationship of God's love and hatred through this beautiful kind of poetic language. In Hosea 11, it shows that God raised Israel lovingly as a son. But then that son took advantage, turned away, rebelled against God, despised God, turned towards other things, took advantage of God's love, and this angers God, stirs up hatred in God, and he seeks to punish Israel, to destroy them. But then he is heartbroken. And it says in Hosea 11, how could I give you up, Ephraim? How could I hand you over, O Israel? Let's just personalize that for a moment, right? Let's personalize this. God raised us lovingly. He created us lovingly, fearfully and wonderfully created us. But then we have rebelled against God. We have taken advantage of his love and we have despised him and rejected him and turned from him toward the world. And this angers God. Our wickedness angers God, and he seeks to punish us, to give us our just punishment. But then he is heartbroken. How could I give you up, Tommy? How could I hand you over, Tommy? Hosea 11 says his heart recoils within him and he is moved by his loving compassion to not destroy. It goes on in Hosea to call them to repentance and to receive God's forgiveness. Do you see the beauty in that? Do you see the beauty of God's love? When we have turned away, rejected his love. Yes, this angers God. He hates wickedness. And he is heartbroken over it. But his heart recoils inside, and he is moved by his compassionate love. And he calls us to repentance and to receive his forgiveness. It's beautiful. It is a beautiful picture. And you might be wondering, well, how does God do this? Like, how can God balance these two things that seem to be opposite? He says in Hosea 11, after he says all of this, kind of as though, how can I do this? He says, for I am God and not a man. I am God and not a man. I do not love like you love or hate like you hate. I am not a man, I am God. He says, the Holy One among you, the perfect one, the unblemished one, the pure one. And so how can God perfectly love and hate simultaneously? It is because he is God and not a man, the Holy One among you. So this statement, how do we live out the principles of this statement? What is the Christian ethic of this statement? What should we do with this? We've learned about God's love and his hate of sin, and what do we do with this? Well, this next section is just called Just Do It, TM. Don't want to get in trouble. How do we live this out? Well, let me start by saying how we typically see this lived out in the wrong ways. The wrong ways that we see this being lived out is sometimes on the two extremes. On the one extreme, like we said before, there's the people who use this phrase or this ethic to cast judgment upon other people, right? The self-righteous. I'm just going to stand over here and I'm going to point my finger at all of the sinners and tell them how bad they are. And yeah, God loves you, but he hates your sin. And so when they use this phrase that God loves you or I love you, but God hates the sin, or I hate the sin, what they actually are saying, that I hate you, and God hates you, and God hates your sin, and I hate your sin, right? This is the self-righteous person. Expecting somehow for the unbelieving world to act like believers. Impossible. And casting judgment upon them. Standing in the seat of God. Being judgmental, self-righteous. I tend towards this. I struggle with self-righteousness all the time, especially when I see evil in the world and wickedness. And so here's what I say to myself is I say, love the sinner, hate the sin, and hate my own sin more. Love the sinner, hate, abhor what is evil, but hate my sin more. Hate my own sin. Before I go around pointing out the speck in other people's eye, I need to remove the log from my own eye and not become self-righteous and judgmental. The other side of this, the other extreme that we see this being lived out more, I think, pretty commonly now is the conforming Christian. The conforming Christian. And when they say love the sinner, hate the sin, what they're really saying is love the sinner and excuse the sin. Or love the sinner and in sometimes extreme cases, love the sin as well. Listen, they're just being their authentic self, and God loves them, and I love them, and so they can do, you know, they need to continue to be themselves. They don't need to change who they are. I don't care what the Bible says. God loves them, and they don't need to change. It's an excuse of the sin. It is a conforming of the Christian. And they tend to bring up Jesus in this conversation. Well, don't you see Jesus went and hung out with sinners, and he loved sinners, and they use the word affirmed sinners. But here's the piece that I think is missing from that, is that whenever Jesus went and hung out with sinners and loved sinners, he did indeed do that. Amen? He did do that. But what did he do? He called them to repent. He called them to repent. And Jesus wasn't the one who conformed to what they were struggling with. They are the ones that walked away changed by Jesus. And too much we see the conforming Christian happen in our world in Christianity today, where we excuse sin and conform even to sin. We should love people, amen. This is the New Testament cruciform Christian ethic. Jesus says to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus says to love your enemies and bless those who persecute you. We are to love people in the way that God loves them, patient, kind, not envious or boastful, not rejoicing in wrongdoing, but rejoicing in the truth, right? We are to love like God, our Father, loves. We are to love people. And we are to abhor what is evil. Hate wickedness in the world. Let's add this part to the end. Let's also love the justice of God. Love the justice of God. It is a perfect and holy justice that is going to come and judge the wicked. And in his perfect justice, the guilty will not be cleared. The wicked will not be cleared. We can actually love God's justice. Did you know that? We can love God's justice. On the day, he will come and he will destroy wickedness and he will set things all right. That is a thing that we can love and plead for. God, may your justice come in our wicked world today. We can love his justice, and we can love people, and we can abhor what is evil, because we should be like our Father in heaven. And so, I don't think that we need this phrase. I think that we should abandon the phrase because it is too much of an oversimplification. It is too misleading. It is too incomplete. And to be honest with you, it is ineffective. It is ineffective. In fact, I'm going to give you an example. Probably the most common example that you and I see in this modern day is we see Christians using this phrase with people who struggle with SOGI issues. If you don't know what SOGI is, S-O-G-I, sexual orientation, gender identity. Okay, we see this phrase used to them all the time. God loves you, but he hates the sin, right? We see this all over social media, all over the place. And it is completely ineffective, completely ineffective. Do you know why it's ineffective? Because if you have ever talked with someone who struggles with SOGI issues, you will know that that it is not just something that they do, an action that they do. They believe that it is truly who they are. So a person who is struggling with homosexuality is not just acting in homosexuality. They believe that it is who they are. They believe that they were born that way. They believe that gender identity. They do not believe that it's just something that they do. They believe that it is truly who they are. And so when they hear the phrase, love the sinner, hate the sin, all they hear is that God hates them and that you hate them, because they do not separate and make the distinction between sin and sinner. It is ineffective completely. And so we should throw the phrase out. That is my conclusion of our time. Wow, that took a really long time to just say that. We should ditch the phrase, and we shouldn't replace it with nothing. Here's what we should replace it to, and this is going to blow your mind. We should replace it with preaching the gospel. Because I think that most people use this phrase as a substitute for the gospel. They say, I shared Jesus today. I told them that God loves them and he hates their sin. And they use it as a replacement for the gospel. Listen to me, this is no replacement for the gospel. And we should abandon this phrase and we should preach the gospel. Some people want to use this phrase because they want to do some PR work for God, right? They want to up God's image in the world. We want to make God look better somehow to the culture. Well, if I preach the gospel, it's going to be offensive. Yes, the gospel is offensive. The gospel is absolutely offensive. Now listen, hear me. You don't have to be more offensive than the gospel, right? Like you don't have to go over the top in offense to the gospel. The gospel by itself is offensive. Matthew 10, 22, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Why will we be hated by all? Because we're preaching the message that Jesus preached. And Jesus was hated by the world. And so we will be hated by the world because it is offensive to the world, the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is offensive. Some people are like, well, I just want to use this nice phrase because I don't want, like, you know, the people, the world, they view the gospel as it's so foolish to them. They don't understand it. They don't get it. Yeah. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the word of the cross is folly or foolish to those who are perishing, but to us, listen to this, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. It is foolish and folly to the world, but to those who are being saved, the gospel is the power of God. And listen to me, as we are sharing Jesus with people, we cannot rob them of the power of God in the gospel. We must share and preach the gospel with them. This is the power of God. And so this topic, I know, it leads to so many questions. So many, hundreds, maybe thousands of questions of how do I operate in love and abhor evil? And so what do I do with these questions that I've had? Because I want to love my people who are struggling with this soji issue. And do I go to the wedding? And do I, this person who's stuck in sin, do I hang out with them? And do I spend time with them? Or what do I do with that? There's so many questions that come up in this topic of how do I love them, abhor what is evil, and love the justice of God. And there's no cookie cutter answer that I can give you because most of the questions that operate in this place are something called the diaphora. They're indifferent. God doesn't speak directly to it, and we need to use the wisdom of God to decide and find out what we should be doing in these certain difficult situations. And I want you to know that we are going to go through the topic of sexual orientation and gender identity in one of our sermons. I know that you probably want so much more of, let's keep talking about this, right? But these sermons are meant to be a primer into these topics, a starting place into these topics, to be helpful for us to move forward in answering these questions in our life. And so I want to leave you with a couple of principles of how I go about making decisions that are complicated, cultural issues. How do I start to wrestle through these questions and things and issues? How do I do that? Well, first, we do it biblically. We do it biblically. What does God's word say about it? Does God's word speak directly to it? What does God's word say? Are there principles in God's word that I can pull out and apply to this situation or this question? We need to first see what God's word says biblically, and then we need to approach this convictionally. What am I personally convicted of? In my reading of God's word, how is the Holy Spirit convicting my heart in certain questions and issues? Praying about it. God, is this the right conviction to have? How should I handle this situation? Would you convict my heart one way or the other? It is a personal conviction. Listen, I have these. You have these. There are weddings that I will do, and there are weddings that I won't do as a pastor because I have personal convictions about them. We need to handle them biblically. We need to handle them convictionally. And then here's the last thing. We need to handle them communally. Inside of community, we shouldn't be thinking about these things in isolation, in our bed, at home, by ourselves. We should be bringing these questions and topics to our community, to others who love God, because there is wisdom in the multitude of counselors, Proverbs says. And so we bring them to our community, not only for wisdom, but also so that we can see how my actions are going to be read by my brothers and sisters. Remember, adiaphora, indifference. Will this lead my brother and sister to sin? Will my actions in this lead my brother and sister into sin? Or will this cloud the gospel to the one I'm trying to reach it with? Will it cloud the gospel in their life, my actions on this particular subject? We need to handle it biblically, convictionally, and communally. And these are hard questions. And we need to wrestle together with all of these questions. And I'm thankful that we're going through this as a church to start to wrestle through these questions together as a community and continuing to do so. And even though this is just a starting place, I'm hoping that God will do a wonderful work in us and in our church in this area and in many others. But let us love people, let us abhor what is evil, and let us love the justice of God. Amen. Let's pray. God, we are so thankful for your word and its instruction to us. God, we're so thankful for your love, which is so vast and amazing. It's almost incomprehensible. It is, in a lot of ways, incomprehensible. And so, Lord, we're so thankful for your love. And Lord, would you help us to love like you? Would you help us to love people like you love people? And Lord, would you also, at the same time, help us to abhor what is evil, what is wicked? Lord, would we pray and plead for your justice, your perfect, pure, holy justice, your righteous justice to come to make all things right, to wipe out wickedness from among us? Lord, it grieves our heart to see the wickedness in our world, and so, Lord, may your justice come. And Lord, as we live here on earth and interact with others, even though they may not agree with us or think the same as us, Lord, would you give us a heart just to love them, to be kind and patient with them, but to also speak truth to them in love and with grace. We need your help with this, Lord. It is not easy in our culture today to live this Christian ethic, but Lord, would you help us to be like your son, Jesus, who did this perfectly? Give us the strength and the courage to do it, Lord. We love you. We thank you for our time. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet. reigns, yes he does. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Oh, hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days, hallelujah, he reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns over everything. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God, you reign forever all my days. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hear your people sing hallelujah. Our strength, our shield, our
right. We look to the Lord for our help. We look to the Lord for direction and strength. We look to the Lord for answers. For any of the questions we have, we look to his word for truth. And that's what we're going for in this series. So keep leaning in to the questions. Most importantly, God's answers. His thoughts are higher. His ways are higher. Lord, show us your thoughts. That's what we want as a church family. If we can pray for you today, we'd love to do that. We've got staff and leaders who will be right up here up front. We'd love to take that opportunity and do it. It is Father's Day. Did we say that yet? So happy Father's Day. Hey, something kind of fun in the lobby. There's a little photo op. If your dad's with you today, go get a picture. He'll love that. Frame it. It'll be amazing. There's also a place for dad jokes. You can write a dad joke. Only dads get to write a dad joke. But you can read them. Can I give you one? This is from this morning. My wife said I should do lunges to stay in shape. That would be a big step forward. Thankful for our dads. Hey, it's great to worship together today. If we can pray for you, let us know. You are loved.